now we will go into our lesson study. And Brother Sean Simmons is going to be taking our lesson for today, looking at lessons for living. And we're asking that you give him your utmost attention. God bless you.
Okay, no problem. No. But I'm afraid that I can slide because it's a little bit.
Morning, Sabbath School.
I know.
Morning, Sabbath School.
I don't think it would, though.
How has it been?
I don't think it.
How was the week?
Oh, it's
I hope that you all will be blessed. Right. On the premise of what we would have discussed in the lesson, we should deem it a privilege to be here this morning. To worship unmolested without any force.
Right.
It is an extreme blessing that God has allowed us to partake in at this time of history. Knowing that the road will get a bit rugged as we go forward. Our lesson this morning is entitled From the Furnace to. I was told that I have just about 10 minutes, so we have to condense it as much as possible. Let's have a word of prayer before we go into our lesson. Eternal God and Father, we're indeed grateful for your many blessings towards us and to allowing us to be here in such a sacred spot, at such a sacred time. May your will be with us even now. Speak to our minds and our hearts, we pray. In Jesus' loving name.
Amen.
Because we only have 10 minutes, just about. I often like to ask the question, what would have stood out for you as you would have studied the lesson? What would have stood out? Any of us would have studied the lesson. Anything that your warrant needs to be expressed or for us to ponder or elaborate on. Anything. If I don't get any answers, then I just ruin the lesson. Can someone with a mic?
The one thing that struck me was our having complete and unconditional faith and trust in God. Not worrying or thinking about anything, just trusting.
Nice.
The thing that struck me is that God's grace towards sinners is lavish at many times. I'm looking at it from the standpoint of Nebuchadnezzar. He had an experience before with Daniel and his stewards, and he realized that God is in control. Yet he was stubborn, and God gave him another chance to accept him. Even though he was challenging God, God still gave him a chance.
That point, because usually we look at the tribute rewards. And we negate the fact that Nebuchadnezzar played a great part in regards to his function in the whole scheme of it all.
I believe what's known for me is that the devil already has a consequence for those who do not want to serve him. Likewise, we should endeavor to serve God even until the end, because the consequence is already there. The fiery furnace was already built. It was never an afterthought. So we must be faithful in knowing that we will go through trials and tribulations.
All right, and it is said that the furnace actually could have very well been an altar, a place where they would have done their sacrifices and so forth. So even within a religious context, we can find ourselves in persecution. Even in a religious context. There's a hand back there, and then I'll endeavor to throw us forward.
The fiery furnace was not the first experience that they had to show and test their faith. They had their faith tested when they first arrived in Babylon, when they had to choose whether to eat from the king's table or not. And then their faith was exercised again when the king decided to kill all the wise men, and God miraculously saved them with the dream given to Daniel and its interpretation. So they had been exercising their faith all along and seeing results from it. You cannot expect to be faithful in a big test if along the way you're not exercising it.
All right, our lesson also said in regards to that, that when Nebuchadnezzar would have set up the image, they considered it to be a counterfeit, a replica in a sense, in its own right, of what they would have accustomed to in terms of worshiping. So Nebuchadnezzar actually was trying to usurp the worship experience of God. Someone else have this mic.
I'll have
to
start with this one because the lesson reached home to me. Because of the Hebrew boys standing up before God, it won the heart of the king. His conversion came about because of these men standing up before God. You know what that tells me? If I am faithful to God, even the king can be converted to Christ.
Amen. And this brings me to mind with what we would have heard last night in regards to some of our best sermon, that we ought to be faithful, because they would have been faithful even before they had that experience. And sometimes, even though you're witnessing, it's not necessarily mean that someone will accept right away. So we have to have that steadfastness in terms of trying to get a person's attention.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. What stood out to me this lesson confused me. Here we saw the three Hebrew boys becoming criminals, doing the right thing.
Becoming criminals. That's a kind of heavy one. There needs some explanation there briefly.
I am a very short speaker, but I will not be brief. I might be a little confused, but I'm really confused. God made the law, and if you break that law, you become a sinner. Government make laws, and if you break that law, you become a criminal. A criminal is a person that commits a crime. However, every criminal is not a sinner. And every sinner is not a criminal. For long after this story has struck me, thou shalt not kill. That's God's law. Now if I kill anybody, then I will be a sinner. Don't go more than 80 miles per hour. If I go 180, I've committed a crime. Therefore, I've become a criminal. State legislators and legislatures took God's law, thou shalt not kill, and bring it now to the land. Now, if I kill anybody, I not just become a sinner, but I also become a criminal. Okay? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were placed in a position where they had to choose to become sinners or criminals. Some shall have no other gods before me. Now, if they had power, I believe with all my heart that they would have been a sinner. But they were rebellious to the government, doing the right thing to become criminals.
All right.
And they did not bow down to the image. So they choose to be criminals.
much, my brother, but we will give you another week to expand on it.
At times we can narrow in as we endeavor to, and in sense confuse ourselves, but we have the right motives. God is always faithful to those who are diligent. We realize that the motives of the lesson were worship, faithfulness, and deliverance. Right? Now we made mention of the worship experience. Nebuchadnezzar would have built an image unto himself, or an image unto the gods. And the man worship not only by one person, not in isolation, but worship of all the then world. But you have three young men who decided that they would not bow to the image. Now they could have bowed and reserved in their hearts or in their mind. What's wrong if I physically bow? But I know in my heart I am serving God. How would that play out? Should that be something for us to consider? And how many of us are doing that even today? We come to church faithfully. We do all the ritualistic things, but deep inside our hearts, we are not doing that which we know we are to do. Now these three Hebrew boys decided they would not bow. You recognize that all the others would have bowed. You always have a set of people who just follow the norm. Just follow the go-alongs. Because if the question or if the command would have been made to bow, how these Chaldeans would have been able to see others not bowing? There are persons who in church when the sermon is being preached and they're having their own conversation, some of us like that. The idea of bowing did not mean a thing to them. But to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, it speaks volume, because they understood that they are going against the grain of God. How many of us, when we make a decision, that we calculate this decision and realize that we are going against the grain of God?
Okay, good morning, everyone. A pivotal point is brought up in the lesson, even as we prepare to wrap up. All of us here this morning, we have our own challenges that only God knows about. So if we miss anything in the lesson, one thing we should keep in mind is that God is able. Songwriter says, we may pray and it seems as if things is not working out our way, but we must be confident He is working out everything for our own good. So when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stood before the king, and the king said, listen, I'm giving you a second chance. He said, don't even think about it, because at the end of the day, we're willing to die. And if we die, we die. If we live, we live, because God is still able. And that is the kind of encouragement, the kind of strength that we need as God's people as we go through life, because in the near future, there will be an image to challenge the people of God.
And we will close on this note. Those of us who have been here earlier when Pastor Light made his statement, let us keep that in mind, that we have a people out there who we are commanded to reach for God's kingdom. May the Lord continue to bless us as we worship today.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Sean, for so ably leading us in our lesson. Sunny, did you enjoy it? Amen. Amen. And now we continue with our morning's program. We're going to have our speakers, and we will ask Pastor Kesslyn Daisley Howe to come and introduce our speakers.
Amen.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Pleasant Sabbath to you. It's
always good to be in God's house on His holy Sabbath day, where we could meet each other and fellowship. Amen?
Amen.
Last night we had a wonderful time in God. Those of you who were here, let me hear you say amen.
Amen.
We had a wonderful time in God, and we had some life lessons that I know we would not forget in a hurry. We were reminded by Samora Best, and we were also reminded by Shibiki Vipress, along with Dave Nichols, that when we put our best foot forward with God, in all of their various messages, the one thing that stands out is, when we put our best foot forward with God and we are committed to God, we will get Jesus' word done. Is that a good summation? Today we have three other speakers who will share with us God's message from their personal devotion. Because these life lessons are not things that you can just pick out of scripture. It must first affect you. And so starting with us today, we have Jamal Greenidge. Jamal Greenidge hails from South Trinidad, Arim to be exact. He's a fourth year theologian, very quiet gentleman, but as the saying goes, still waters run how? So today we should have some good word. We also have with us Peter Missoul. Peter Missoul hails from St. Lucia. He's also a fourth-year theologian, very cheerful, very helpful, and so I'm sure his spirit will come through in the message that he has for us today. We also have Jermaine Andrews, who hails from Guyana. Jermaine Andrews is married, he has three children, he's a fourth-year theologian, and today I am sure his quiet, sturdy demeanor will come through in the message that he has for us. So we are not at the starters block today. Actually, we are on our knees today. And I pray that when they rise to speak, that God's Holy Spirit will bless our hearts. We start with the Jumon Bridge.
Good morning, saints of God. Scripture is taken from Acts chapter 16, verse 16 through 26. I read in your hearing. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her master much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and Silas, and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her master saw that the hopes of their gain was gone, they called Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto their rulers, and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city, and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrate rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer who has received such charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's bonds were loose. This morning I would like to speak to us briefly on the topic, praise through the pain. Praise through the pain, Father God. Hide me behind your cross, and let Jesus and him crucified be seen, be felt, and be lifted up in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. The story is told of two old friends who met each other one day, and one of them looked like the world was on his shoulders. So his friend asked him, "What is the matter? Why you look so gloom?" To this he responded, "3 weeks ago, my great-grandmother died and left $500,000 in my name. 1 week after, an uncle from the state sent $100,000 to my account." In awe, the friend responded, "Wow, you have been blessed." Then the first continued, "Last week, my brother left his entire company in my name." Confused, the friend said, "You receive all this, then why you look so depressed?" He said, "You see, this week, no one left me anything." There are many people who live with that attitude. Life is good only when things go good. This exists even among church people, Samuel. You see, we know how to rejoice and praise God only when things are going our way. But as soon as things turn, we can't find in our hearts to give a thankful word. You see, but life is not always like that. Life is like a roller coaster. Sometimes up, sometimes down, sometimes all the way to the ground. You see, there will be good days, but there will also be the not so good days. But we need to learn to praise God in every circumstance. That is the lesson we learned from the experience of Paul and Silas when they had their painful prison experience. The Bible tells that Paul and Silas were commissioned by God to go spread the gospel in Macedonia. Acts 16, 10, 14 and 15 tells us that they baptized not just a rich woman, but a woman and her entire household. Now I could imagine the joy Paul must have felt winning his first soul. Now I imagine the joy that they both felt knowing that many more people will come to Christ through this family. That was one of the good days. Soul winning. But then on, it would appear that things went south, straight into the not so good days. The Bible says that the official arrested Paul and Silas and threw them into prison. They did not just throw them into prison. The Bible tells us in verse 22 and 23 that their clothes were ripped off and stripes were laid on them. In other words, they were not just beaten and imprisoned, but they were publicly humiliated and severely punished. Not only that, the scripture says
church. You see, the inner prison is known to be the most secure and uncomfortable area. In the inner prison, there was any light. In the inner prison, there was little ventilation because it was at the lowest point of the prison. You see, if that weren't bad enough, their feet was placed in stocks, which is a wooden structure with two holes designed to keep their feet secured under bar. Now I can imagine the pain they were experiencing. Their experience in Macedonia went from mountain high to valley low, from joy to sorrow, from free to detained, from peace to pain. Now at this point, is where many of us would have said, Lord, what did I do to deserve this? Lord, do you really love me? Lord, did you really send me here? But the Bible says in verse 25, at midnight, I said at midnight, Paul and Silas pray and start praising unto God. You see, at midnight is known to be the time where everyone is asleep. But the Bible says it is at midnight that Paul and Silas pray and start praises unto God. You see, it is one thing to pray when you are distressed, but it's another thing to worship God when you are in a painful situation. You see, to me, praying might be easier than praising when you are in a painful situation because you want God to deliver you and heal you from the situation. But praising is saying, God, thank you. Praising is saying, God, you good. You see, they had a will, despite of everything they had been through, to praise God. These men were stripped, humiliated, beaten, imprisoned, cold, uncomfortable, but they praised God for his goodness to them. They were praising through the spirit. See, this is the mantra of Paul, because he did not just do it, but he recommended. In Philippians 4:4, Paul writes, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. You see, Paul was not confused, but he was committed. You see, and the Bible says that while they were praying and praising, the prisoners heard them. And at midnight, these men were praying and singing aloud. And the prison was transformed into a thanksgiving service. And God shook the prison, and their bonds were loose. And you know the rest of the story. See, when we face the sorrows of life, think not that God has abandoned you. When you go through your trouble, the people who know not God are watching to see how you deal with it. See, when you go through your trials, you are not alone. Every Paul has a Silas. See, whatever situation we face, we need to push through the pain. We need to be like Job and say, though he slay me, I will trust God. We need to say like David, I was young, but now I'm old, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken. See, where we are physically should not affect our level of spirituality. Our present situation should not affect our spiritual connection. There isn't a situation that we face in life where God is not there with us. Therefore, our pain should not alter or detain our praise. See, whatever the situation, we need to praise through the pain.
See, when we give him praise, we experience joy in the midst of sorrow. We experience courage in the midst of conflict. When we give him praise, we get renewed strength in the midst of weakness. We feel contentment in the midst of crisis. We get boldness in the midst of our battles. See, whatever our trial, our tribulation, we still need to praise through the pain. Good morning, church.
You made me down and feel that God somehow forgotten. That you are faced with circumstances that you can't get through. And right now it seems that there's no way out and you're going under. But God's proven time and time again, he'll take care of you. You
You may not know how, you may not know when, but you'll do it again.
Began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. But he cried the more a great deal, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. And he casting away his garment rose and came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole. And immediately, Mark says, he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. The message is entitled, Dig a Little Deeper. Dig a Little Deeper. From the chronology of the passage and the trajectory that Jesus and his disciples took, we recognize that they were on their way to the Passover. The city of Jericho, you see, was one of the last places they would meet before they arrived at Jerusalem. On that occasion, Jesus and the disciples would encounter a crowd along the way, and amongst that crowd was a bold, blind man named Bartimaeus. The presence of a beggar just outside the city gates was a common sight in the ancient Near East. But Bartimaeus was not just another blind beggar. Bartimaeus desperately wanted to see. The experience of a blind beggar was not easy for him. See, as a blind man, he was not able to work, earn a living, or provide for a family. He was not even able to engage in corporate worship because no blind or lame person was allowed into the temple. He was living in darkness. Socially, he was a nobody. No one would ask how Bartimaeus was doing or what Bartimaeus had been up to. There was no regard for him by anyone in society. His blindness made him live in a world of aloneness in the midst of a crowded city. Bartimaeus longed to see. And on that day, Bartimaeus heard that Jesus was passing his way. Jesus, the solution to his problem, was passing his way. Jesus, the answer to all his questions, was passing his way. What do you do when the solution to your problem is available? Verse 47 says, and when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. But the text includes some of the most ironic statements in the gospel. As he's crying for help, Mark says in verse 48, and many charged him that he should hold his peace. Many of the people in the crowd told him to shut up, Shut up. Jesus does not have time for blind beggars like you. He is too busy for the lesser mortals like beggars. You are nobody. Now, Bartimaeus was not just facing a problem because he was blind. He was facing a problem also because people had brought that problem upon him. He was treated as though he had no value. His challenge and needs did not matter. Imagine out of all the people standing around, he is the least likely to get a chance to meet Jesus, yet they are preventing him from getting his blessing. He was treated like he was invisible. He could not see them because he was blind, but they chose not to see him. They told him to shut up. Ironically, you would think this group of people would want to help the man to receive his sight. During Jesus' ministries, scores of sick folk who needed healing were brought to Jesus by other people. On one instance, even a lame man's friend broke the roof just so that he could have access to Jesus. But Bartimaeus was all alone in his struggle. And when he cried for help, the crowd tried to silence him. Sometimes our help and our hindrance comes from the place that we least expect. The Bartimaeus in our world often learn to find out that not everyone around you will always sympathize with your struggle. The people with eyes don't understand the experience of the blind. The people who have can hardly understand the cries of the have-nots. The people with clothes do not understand the pleas of the naked. The A student cannot understand the struggle of the C student. So when Bartimaeus cried out to Jesus, many in the crowd said, "Shut your mouth." But Bartimaeus knew that if you cannot work with what you don't have, you have to work with what you have. He didn't have eyes, but he had a big mouth. I imagine Bartimaeus toying with himself. He said, "Since I cannot use my eyes to help me see, I will use my mouth to get him to come to me." Mark says, when the people told him to be quiet, he cried out even louder, "Thou son of David, have mercy on me." Some might have been intimidated when they told him to be shut up, but not Bartimaeus. You see, he dug in deep and belted out again. He did not have any eloquent speech prepared, but just a distressed cry for help. Bartimaeus was fighting against the odds and would not give up. The more they tried to prevent him, was the more he continued to shout. He continued to dig deeper and deeper until he cried out to the Lord. And his cries did not go unheard. Amidst the noise of the people, Jesus heard his cries. And Jesus called him close and gave him sight. The story of this blind, bold, boisterous beggar from Jericho is a testimony to every child of God who might be facing obstacles along the way of life. Bartimaeus shows us that in order to receive deliverance, sometimes we will have to persevere against the odds. The more the enemy tries to silence, is the louder you have to cry to God. And we too will never receive our breakthroughs by sitting around and feeling sorry for ourselves. And whenever you are close to deliverance, the more the enemy will try to silence you, I've realized that sometimes God wants to see how badly we want what we are asking for. So when your back is against the wall and you cannot see the way out of financial challenges, am I speaking to somebody this morning? You need to dig a little deeper and cry louder. When your assignments are stacked up higher than you can see, you need to dig deeper and cry louder. When sickness grips you without reprieve and you cannot see a way out of your medical situation, you need to dig deeper and cry louder. When you are lonely and need someone in your life, you need to dig deeper and cry louder. Only God can understand your struggle and your pain, and He only has the solution to your problem. So don't let the enemy around you silence you. Don't let them tell you to shut up. The more he tries to tell you shut up is the more you need to cry out to God. Just do like Bartimaeus. Dig a little deeper until you receive your breakthrough.
Thank you. to us from the book of Luke. Luke chapter 17, verses 11 to 20. Luke chapter 17, verses 11 to 20. The Bible says, "And it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, Go, shew yourselves unto the priests. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, and with a loud voice glorified God, and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that returned to give glory to God, save this stranger. Verse 19. And he said unto him, Arise, go thy way. Thy faith hath made thee whole. The title of today's discourse is More Than Anything. More Than Anything. Natalie Diane Grant, an American singer and songwriter of contemporary Christian music, recorded a song called More Than Anything. The lyrics were inspired by the story of a woman battling a horrific cancer. Yet her heart's cry was, I know you can heal me, Lord, but even if you choose not to in this life, help me want the healer more than the healing. That song has helped many to appreciate that we need to value God more than anything we can get from God. And in a nutshell, that is exactly the lesson that we will learn from our text. In Luke chapter 17, verse 11, the author places Jesus en route to Jerusalem, passing along the borders of Samaria and Galilee. As he entered an unnamed village, the Savior was summoned by 10 desperate, diseased men. Identified by torn clothes and scaly skin, they banded together and shouted in chorus, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. The plague of their disease demanded that they withdraw themselves from close human contact. And from a distance, they cried out in desperation for mercy. And if you were in the company of our Lord, you could hear their husky, helpless appeal, Jesus, Master, have mercy. Linguistically, the name Jesus conveys the idea that Yahweh delivers, saves, rescues. So in a sense, they were summoning to the Lord to live up to his name. But they did not only recognize him as able to grant mercy, they also acknowledged him as master. The plea for mercy suggests that they knew that he could grant them what they needed, and the title suggested that they were willing to do whatever he commanded. So even in their sick, diseased state, they were convicted in their hearts that he was both Savior and Lord. Dr. John MacArthur, commenting on the text, states that the request expresses a recognition of superior power and one who at the same time is approachable. And these 10 sick men cried out to Jesus because they wanted healing more than anything. Luke adds in the next verse that he, Jesus, saw them. Indeed, Jesus saw them as no other eyes could ever see them. To the eyes of most men, these were unattractive, even repulsive in appearance. But in the eyes of Jesus, they were objects of his love and the deep compassion of his tender heart. He heard in their voices and saw in their expressions that they wanted healing more than anything. They longed to be relieved from the dreaded disease and be restored and reinstated into their respective residential communities. In verse 14 of our text, all men were granted their specific request. As they were going, they were healed. Problem solved. They got what they wanted more than anything. Notice, faith, however meager, was required by all 10 leprous men. When our Lord told them to go and show themselves to the priests, they acted in obedience and trust that they would be healed of their leprosy. They knew that they could not go to the priests unless they were healed. But the record did not say that they were healed and they went. No, it says, as they were going, they were healed. They wanted to be healed so badly that they were determined to do whatever Jesus said, even though for many it might seem to make no sense. But they went. And in their minds, they were going to get their healing. The remaining verses, however, of our text instruct us concerning one of those men. One of the 10. Luke chapter 17, verses 15 and 16 says, and one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. Something, ladies and gentlemen, happened in the mind of this one man when he received his healing. And he decided that Jesus, the healer, was more important to him than the healing that he had so desperately wanted. He knew that the healer is more important than the healing. Verse 19 says, Jesus said to him, stand up and go. Your faith has made you well. The one leper who returned exercised a higher level of faith. That is pistis faith. The kind that is directed to a person. West, in his study of pistis, explains that this word refers to the faith which a lost sinner must place in the Lord Jesus in order to be saved. We too need to know that Jesus is worth more to us than anything that we can get from him. We need to stop looking to him for what we can get from him and turn to him for him. He is more than anything. He is more than anything because he comes with everything we need. And when we receive him, we receive everything that heaven provides. Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 32, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us what? All things. The truth is, Jesus is not just the bank manager to whom we go when we need a loan. Jesus is the bank. Jesus is the complete package, so we don't need him to give us anything but himself. Students, we must want Jesus more than we want him to pay our school fees. Same students, we must want Jesus more than we want him to help us get an A. Singles, we must want Jesus more than we want him to give us a partner. Preachers, we must want Jesus more than we want him to empower us to preach. Like the one leper who came back, we must want Jesus more than anything. Amen. Remember Natalie's story. She looked at the life, when Natalie looked at the life story of the woman battling with cancer, and her heart cried out, I know you can heal me, Lord, but even if you choose not to in this life, help me want the healer more than anything else, more than the healer. She wrote the lyrics in the song I introduced to you, more than anything. I pray that those words would be the sentiment of our hearts. Lord, in spite of all that I want you to do for me, in spite of all that I want from you, I still want you more than anything.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Singing praises.
Of Jamal Greenwich and Peter Missoul and Jermaine Andrews, and for the expository narrative and exegetical expose that we have just experienced, I'm sure we will not forget, for they spoke with clarity and they made contact with us with their eyes, and the direction of their sermon was well done. So the takeaway for us this morning is praying through the pain is the catalyst that would exponentially accelerate our digging deeper and crying louder. And when we have received Jesus, then we would finally realize that he is more than anything we have ever wanted. Thank you, students, for sharing with us. And I thank all of you for sharing this experience with us. May God richly bless us. And I hope that as we leave this part of the program, we would leave with the savor of God's word in our lips, for the food is yet to come. God's blessings.
good morning and pleasant Sabbath. Welcome to the announcement segment of your Caring University Church, University of the Southern Caribbean Church. All platform personnel asked to assemble in the vestry. That's the room opposite the elevator. That would be the ministerial students. The third and fourth year students are asked to assemble outside the vestry, and the first and second year students on the opposite end, please. Deacons and deaconesses, as well as our ministerial students who are specifically assigned to the USC church, are asked to immediately assemble at the front of the church to meet with Pastor Dixon at the end of the service. Please note, church board members, that church board meeting will be held today at 5:30 p.m. instead of the previously announced 6:30. Once again, church board meeting will be held at 5:30 p.m. instead of the previously announced 6:30. New administrators have been elected to the South Caribbean Conference to serve for the next 4 years. Some of the administrators include ADRA, Pastor Emmanuel Peters, Adult and Early Childhood Education and Associate Education Director, Sister Elma Bruce Frederick, ASI Coordinator, Pastor Leslie Moses, Assistant Communication Director, Brother Sheldon Moore, Assistant Technical Director, Brother Robert Dilworth, Auditor, Sister Jennifer Paris, Community Services Director, Pastor Nigel Walcott, Chaplaincy Director, Brother Gideon St. Bryce, Director of Education, Sister Jessica Cunningham, Assistant to the President for Evangelism, Pastor Inskip Richards, Field Secretary, Pastor Michael Phillips, HR Manager, Sister Judy Haynes, Music Director, Sister Deborah Ferreira, and Public Affairs and Religious Liberty, Pastor Paul Filbert. Prayer Ministries Coordinator and Men's Ministries Director, Pastor Wayne Sampson. Publishing Director, Pastor Derwin Clark. Publishing Associate Director, Brother Lester Mitchell. Safety Officer and Possibility Ministries Coordinator, Sister Elma Batiste Charles. I missed an announcement. Would you kindly go back to the previous one? Now, when family come to visit, it's always quite an exciting time. And those of us who enjoy 3ABN, I hope that, like me, you all feel that they are family. So I'm quite excited about meeting John and Angela, Loma Kang, and the Mariconis, etc. They'll be coming to Trinidad, and they'll be right here at the University of the Southern Caribbean Church from March 2nd to 7th. And you don't want to miss this. 3ABN, off the box, right here at USC. We're looking forward to it. Thank you.
Amen.
The Community Hospital of Seventh-day Adventist announces current vacancies. There is a vacancy for Chief Medical Officer as well as Chief Nursing Officer. Interested persons wishing to apply for these positions should send a copy of their CV along with copies of relevant certificates and a cover letter to the address shown on the screen. If you would like to have a reminder of this address, feel free to see a member, any member of the communications team. There's also an email address, and the closing date, kindly take note, is Friday, 14th February, 2020. If you apply, this may be a Valentine present to you, a new job. The University of the Southern Caribbean, I Praise, presents an exciting event, one-day music workshop. We know that music is a wonderful vessel through which we give praise to God, but it must be delivered with a certain expertise. And of course, there are those among us who have a great measure of such expertise, and they invite us to join them. There is a fee attached per person. I don't suppose you might be good. Thank you so much. There's a fee attached, as you can see on the screen, and there is also a special fee for groups of five and above. Some of the persons you can expect to share some of that expertise with you include our own choir director, Karen Hislop, our own Pastor Terry John, the very talented Kay Allen, and Chanel Spencer, Daryl Daniel, as well as Cleon Richardson. We look forward to seeing you there. For further information, once again, please contact any member of the communications team. The Children and Adolescent Ministries invites us to its annual Children's Ministries Workshop to be held on Sunday, February 16th, 2020 at Mount Door SDA Church, Industrial Lane, Champlain. All children and adolescent ministries personnel are encouraged to attend. Registration fee can be paid at the South Caribbean Conference cashier. The cost per person is shown on the screen. This cost will cover catering and workshop material and is due, please take note, before February 12, 2020. This is courtesy Pastor Roslyn Batiste Farfan, Women's Children's and Adolescent Ministries Director. Kindly be reminded of our ongoing housekeeping concerns, and the restrooms, concerns and information, that is. The restrooms are to my left, your right. The refreshment stand is just outside the vestry. That way, please feel free to refresh yourselves accordingly. Lost and found items may also be found at the vestry or retrieved at the vestry. We ask that we keep the area that we use to worship as clean as we found it by making use of the garbage disposal facilities. Announcements are to be sent to the following email address on or before Thursday of each week, uscchurchtt@gmail.com. At this time, we invite you to take note of a very special announcement from USC Music.
Choir. Let me see you raise your hands. All right.
This weekend is actually going to be 3 days of spectacular choral activity that is going to be taking place on this campus. We begin on Friday evening. We're going to have Vespers, choral Vespers, right here at 7 p.m. We begin at 7 p.m. sharp, and that is your opportunity to worship and to fellowship with the members of the USC Choral Ensemble. So we are going to feature our women's chorus, our university singers, our university choir and orchestra, and we're also going to be doing some very special collaborations with our guests that are going to be here for that weekend. Joining us from Thursday to the following Monday are going to be 60-something piece choir, the Tacoma Academy Camerata and Chorale from Maryland, USA. They're going to be right here on our campus, and they will be taking part in these activities between Friday and Sunday. So on Friday, we invite everyone to come out. Of course, it's Vespers. It's free of charge. Come out and fellowship with us. It's not going to be a long program, just about an hour long. Invite everybody you know that loves good choral music to come out here on Friday evening. On Saturday night, we're going to have our choral festival finals. All right, and as you see, we're going to have 8 of the top gospel choirs in Trinidad and Tobago that are going to be participating in the event. We have a stellar cast of judges and clinicians that are going to be here. We have Dr. Ariel Quintana, head of choral studies at La Sierra University. We have the director of the Tacoma Academy Chorale. We have Dr. Roger Henry, who is currently the director of the National Philharmonic Orchestra, but his doctorate is actually in choral conducting. And we also have our very own Mr. Boyd Gibson, and they are going to be the judges for the event, and they are also going to be participating in the workshop on Sunday. So after that portion of the event with the 8 choirs is concluded on Saturday night, you're going to hear a very, very special feature performance, mini concert performance by Tacoma Academy. So Saturday night is the night that you don't want to miss. And then for anybody who is interested in developing their technique, either as a conductor or a member of a choir, or you're just interested in getting more information about the choral art, we're going to have a very special workshop on Sunday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. is going to feature all of the facilitators. Conductors are going to be able to use the Tacoma Academy Choir as a lab choir, right?
Is there going to be a cost attached?
Yeah, there is a cost attached to it. I don't know if you want me to say it because it's a Sabbath, but
you can get it from the communication.
It's available on our website, but it's very, very reasonable. We try to make it accessible to everyone. All right. If anybody is interested in discounted tickets for Saturday night, we want you to see the directors of His Love. That's Anton and Renee. Right. Each choir is allowed to bring their entourage along with them, and the entourage receives specially discounted tickets. All right. Outside of that, I think the prices are very, very reasonable.
Are we going to be able to hear our own UCO University Choir and Orchestra at any time during these festivities?
Yeah, we're going to hear UCO, and all of the USC music ensembles are going to be on Friday night. Right? We are not participating on Saturday because obviously we are hosting the competition. But on Friday night is going to be your opportunity to hear those USC music ensembles.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hitzler. Much appreciated. We look forward to seeing you, all of you there for the entire weekend. And we are quite certain that you won't be disappointed. We thank you so much for your indulgence during this time of announcement. We crave your indulgence for a minute longer as we share with you a brief taster of what Tacoma Academy sounds like. Thank you, and God bless you.
Sabbath, Church.
Happy Sabbath.
That didn't sound like USC Church. Happy Sabbath, Church.
Happy Sabbath.
How are you doing this morning? Are you doing good? Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's good to be in the house of God this morning. Amen, amen, amen. This morning we have someone celebrating their birthday. We want to recognize him, one of our fellow theologians, Brother Aubrey Gill. We want him to stand at this time, Brother Aubrey. And let us all sing just the first words of happy birthday to Brother Aubrey this morning. There's only one? No, I know another verse. Trust me. I can teach you another verse. We'll sing happy birthday to Brother Aubrey this morning as he celebrates his birthday today. Let's sing together, Church.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Anybody else is celebrating their birthday today, you can also stand. Anyone else celebrating their birthday? May the good Lord bless you. Anybody else celebrating their birthday today?
May the good Lord bless you.
Oh, thank you. Oh,
all right. May the good Lord bless you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
On behalf of the Carey University Church, we wish you a happy birthday and may God continue. Bless all of you. This morning we are happy to be in God's house and we're going to worship God in the beauty of holiness. You know how we do it at USC. We start with our greeting song. We're going to sing that song, What a Fellowship, What a Joy Divine, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. You're going to take up a notch this morning and let's give God some praise this morning as we worship Him in the beauty of holiness. So let's get up.
Leaning on His arms, I'm burning out to be.
341, to God be the glory. Put our hands together and sing this morning as we give God the highest praise that He is worthy of all of our praise this morning. Church, let's sing together. To God be the glory.
To God be the glory.
Hallelujah. great things he had done. If we really think about the goodness of God, he has been so good to us. And so we are going to hark the voice of Jesus calling. This one has a little jingle about it, so we just want you to just tap your fingers in your seat as we hark the voice of Jesus' calling. Hymn number 359. I'm not hearing you snapping. Come on, you can snap. Come on, let's sing together. Hark the voice.
Hark the voice of Jesus calling.
Who
will go?
Happy in Jesus, but to trust and go to the comforts what we never can prove. Let's sing together.
Jesus,
who will wipe your tears
away, who is able to Yeah. to make public our impressions of you. We declare in the congregation of the saints that there is no God like Jehovah. You have been constant. You have been a great provider. You have been good. You have been excellent. May your promised presence be evident in our worship today. For we pray it and anticipate it through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, the privilege is mine this morning to bid you welcome to the McEachrane's Festival of Preaching. Today, we are not just having church, we're having a celebration. It may be 96 degrees in the shade because of the excitement. And I want you to turn next to someone sitting near to you and say, I am glad I've made it. So let's have the interaction. Now there are some signing the guest book this morning. We have people coming from the east, north, west, and south. We would like to acknowledge your presence. So as I call your name, I'll invite you to stand and just give us a wave. And so we have with us this morning Calvita, Penuel Rock SDA, and Aaron, and Riker. Could you please stand or give us a wave wherever you are? Then we have M. Benfor, Rachel Markanu. We have Waydon Saunders. We're in the back. Waydon Saunders. Mikkel Mason. Okay. We have Colonel Briggs. We have also this morning with us from the IAD. The director of the Inter-American Health Company, Mr. Juan Martin Meza. Let's put our hands together and make him feel welcome. We're so happy to have you here, gracing us with your presence. And we also have V. Samuel from Belmont. Could you please stand and give us a wave? Belmont, let's put our hands together and make the ladies feel welcome. And if I have missed anyone whose name is not in this book, we're blessed to have you this morning. And we want to encourage you to stay with Jesus so that one day your name would remain in the book of books. God bless you and happy Sabbath.
Good morning again, church. Indeed, it is a blessed privilege where we can join together and blend our voices as we sing a song of adoration this morning. And I invite you this morning as we stand and sing hymn number one for our hymn of adoration as we join and sing. Hymn number one, praise to the Lord.
turn to Genesis. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 5. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 5. I will read in your hearing. I'll be reading from the Authorized King James Version. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will shew thee. And I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless thee that And I'll bless them, sorry, that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So Abram departed, as the Lord had spoken unto him. And Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years. And when he departed out of Haran, and Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all the substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran, and they went forth unto into the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came. This is God's word.
May I invite those who this morning have some challenges in life, some specific problem that you want the Lord to answer. May I invite you to come forward so that we can pray together. Please come forward if you have something specific to ask. Some prayers that you were for long ago. Father divine, no one can stand before your throne by his own strength. Your people as one, we all committed sin of commissions and of omissions. We are guilty this morning. But by your love, your great love to us, through Jesus, I and all the ministers, elders, we come unto you this morning and we beg your pardon in the name of Jesus. And you know that when you cleanse us of every sin that we have done, in the name of the mighty Jesus, we can ask anything from you. I come with your people. Came to worship you this morning. We heard this morning preachers from the student school, and they brought us to the throne of grace. We have looked upon heaven opening by their preaching. And we thank you for that. This morning, we have to acknowledge that this has been done through the power of Jesus and the power of the Spirit, but also by a man. Pastor Manzano was a trainer, but he's not with us this morning. He's sick. And I can see the devil smiling. But this morning, we bring Pastor Manzano to your throne of grace. And in the mighty name of Jesus, you call yourself El Rapha, the one who heals. There's no disease beyond your power, and because of that, we, as one body, we bring Pastor Manzano. And at the moment that we are praying, all the hearts are beyond reach. And we know that Jesus can be the best doctor this morning. And he can touch his body and give him, grant him healing in the name of Jesus. Lord, I want to pray for broken couples. The devil enters in the house, destroy the heart of her husband. He brings disrespect. And couples are
broken. This morning, I bring any one of us who is married into your throne of grace. And I beg you to bring back the love, the first love, for this person we said, I do. 20 years ago, 30 years ago, there is no more love because the devil has been invited home. I pray for the brothers. I pray for this country, Trinidad and Tobago. They are facing big challenges, financial challenges, and I pray for the leaders. Lord, give them wisdom. They will take good, right decisions for the people they serve. I want to pray also for USA. We are facing the challenge that the country are facing, financial struggle. I pray for the leadership, for the president and his team, the administrators this morning, that will grant them wisdom. They will know that every time there are troubles, that you are asking them to think, to come unto you and ask, what shall we do? Bless this university, bless the president and his team, and today the Spirit will give them what to do at the appropriate time in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you because this morning we are in front of you. The Spirit fills this place. And the students have preached this morning. And we are fed. But there are still something to come. And I want to pray this morning for Pastor Matthew that he gives to each one of us the word that brings life. If I forget something, Lord, I know your Spirit cannot forget anything. You can read each heart this morning. If there's somebody who is sick in this room, I declare in the name of Jesus that he will not go out from here without being healed by the mighty power of Jesus. May you receive the blessings of the Lord in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Indubitably, today is a high and holy day at the university. During holy days and high days, it's always nice to have high officials in our midst. Would you say amen? It gives us a heightened sense of worship, belonging, and solidarity. And so today, I am delectably honored and feel a great sense of pride to have the Holy Trinity in the university, the President, the VP for Academic Administration, and the VP for Finance. Would you say amen? It says something about their support of the star. So today, as I look at them, they look pastorally, ministerially, ecclesiastically attired. Would you say amen to that? And it shows that they are with us. Immediately behind me, is my worthy president, all in his presidential attire. He looks so good today and young. Would you say amen?
Amen.
Next to him is our noble provost, acting provost of the university. And she looks all complete in her red and black. Would you say amen? She's a lady who walks with a certain kind of panache. Would you say amen? And look at the wistful smile. That's from, that smile is wide as the Demerara. Amen, amen. My good friend and sister. And the man next to her, they call him Prakash, the man with the cash. Dr. Ramuta. He's the man who has the biggest head to think about how to run this university. He needs our prayers. And we thank God for his ministry to keep this ship afloat in spite of the challenges that we face. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to introduce these three persons, and they will bring remarks in the order as outlined in your program. Mr. President, you'll be first.
Pleasant Sabbath, brethren. It's a privilege and pleasure to be here today with this very special program and to have us being participant in this great initiative. I'm very sorry that I could not have been here last night. I spent the last 2 days in Antigua with meetings with the Ministry of Education there, and I returned pretty late last night. So I was on your business, hence I was not able to be here last night. I want to take this opportunity to welcome to USC and to the podium today, Pastor Hesketh Matthews. Pastor Matthews is a very well-known person, Pastor Matthew in the Caribbean. Well selected for this speaking appointment. I know Pastor Matthew for quite some time. He is considered one of the most senior, committed, and dedicated ministers of the Caribbean Union. I must commend Dr. Fass for not going afar, but right in the Caribbean, we can find men of quality to make this presentation. You know, Dr. Chesney had the mind to introduce me to him. This is our president of the University of the Southern Caribbean. And he turned to Dr. Chesney and he said, yes, I know him more than you. We loan him to you. That was good words for me. I was loaned to USC. Welcome back, Pastor Matthew. I want to identify two persons in the audience, Dr. Faz, if you don't mind. Dr. Vernon Andrews, past president of USC. Welcome the audience, Dr. Andrews. And Amanda Ramotel, wife of the vice president, Dr. Prakash Raman. Will you kindly stand? Amen? Yeah. Today, as we said, is a very special day. I have one little concern. Everything went so well, except for one thing that bothered me a little bit. You wonder what bothered the president? Something bothered me quite a bit and still bothering me. That having this special program with all these handsome ministers to be, that I really thought would have had more lovely ladies in the audience. I don't think your influence is weak there, and I hope that. I hope that. I listened to you this morning And I said to myself, these young people came here 4 years ago, and look at how they were, are being transformed into great ministers to be. They spoke with clarity today as they made their presentation. They spoke with conviction. They took that text, elaborated, and used illustrations that we could identify with to make their point. So while they were preaching, my mind went out to the homiletics teacher. And that happens to be Pastor Manzano. And so I would say here at this point that I really appreciate Pastor Manzano and the work that he has done among you. A great work of God. And please let us not go easy in prayer. Let us pray fervently and sincerely for the life and survival of Pastor Manzano. Amen, everybody? Amen. I spoke to all the students of the STAR on Wednesday at the request of Pastor Dr. Pat. And I saw all these students sitting before me, very disciplined young men and women, who were called by God to go up there and finish the mission of God's church. I thank you for your drive, for your initiative, and your commitment. Every time you walk this campus, we are looking at you. And I can say, beyond a shadow of doubt, we are proud of you. We do. Going forward, we'll continue to pray for you. I know you have challenges like everybody else, but I pray that God will see you through successfully. And so as a church, as an administration, we wish you all the best, for fourth-year students in particular, towards graduation and for employment in the missions and the fields. You know, I travel the entire Caribbean Union, and when I see young men and women who have graduated from USC in theology, and the quality of preaching and leadership they are given to the Caribbean Union, I say, God bless USC, God bless the STAR. I want us this morning, in a very tangible way, to put our hands together for Dr. Fattis and his entire team for the tremendous work that he's doing here. Thank you, Dr. Fattis, and your team. May God continue to bless you. And to young men and young women in the field of theology, may God continue to bless you and may you do well. God bless.
Good morning, everyone. What a blessed day to be in the house of the Lord today. You know, the excitement started since last night when we kicked off this McEachrane Festival of Preaching. And for those of you who missed it, you missed a whole lot. We saw rich narratives, we saw expositions, we saw all types of exegeses, and what was coming out was the boldness with which these young people proclaimed the word of the Lord. I'm excited for the Caribbean Union. for the future of the Caribbean Union. Already I see the potential that these young people will have. Last night we had a message from Zamora Best, Currency. Then he was followed by the lone woman in this lineup, and I'm proud to claim her as my countrywoman. Shabiki Vitehouse, with her presentation on Martha's obsession with tasks rather than with the king. She said it in a different way. And of course, she was followed by Dane Nichols. Yeah. Committed. These were powerful sermons. And you know, what I sat there with my husband, and they connected, not just with me, but with the audience, the congregation that we had last night. They left a message, and that is the importance of being able to deliver a word, that the message connects, it resonates, and there is a message that you can take away. So I tip my hat to all the students who have worked tirelessly to be a part of this McEachrane Festival. You have done a fantastic job, and we are tremendously proud of you. I want to also thank all the faculty members, because I know that this has been a team effort. While you have had the leadership behind you, all the faculty that would have contributed to what we saw, what we tasted, what we enjoyed, all of those persons were responsible for what it is that we benefited from. And of course, at the end of it all last night, we had Pastor Hescat Matthew, and he was phenomenal, telling us about the priorities of a ministering heart. What I love about theology is that it's not a regurgitation of the Word of God. Everyone interprets from their own lenses, from the positionality that they bring to the Word, from the way that they're led by the Holy Spirit. And we saw it again this morning. So my heart is full. I know that today is a celebration in Zion. As we celebrate here, may the Lord continue to bless us. May He continue to fill our hearts. And for these young people going out later this year, I know that God will order your steps, and that you will be a blessing. We also had a very powerful music ministers. We had powerful music ministers last night, this morning. May God bless you. Keep working for God, and He will continue to anoint you and to bless you phenomenally. God bless.
And yet another powerful music ministry awaits us. A blessing will be coming to us via Kalisha McDonald. Kalisha Gonzalez. Kalisha. 2 minutes after the next item.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. It is truly a blessing to be here this Sabbath day. At this time, we will take up our tithe, offering, and gifts. But before we do that, I'm going to share with you Deuteronomy 15:10. It says, "Give generously to him, and do so without a grudging heart. Then because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything you put your hands to." Let us pray. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your blessings upon this day, dear Father. Lord, in a special way, we bless the offering that will be placed in the brown basket, dear Father. Lord,
that is for your tithes, offerings, and gifts. Lord, that is to meet all the expenses of this church. Lord, and in a special way, we bless the gifts that will be given in the white basket, dear Lord. Lord, that is to build your sanctuary. Lord, we claim that in 2020, we will start your house. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
We will now invite Tisha Gonzalez to minister to us in song. Make her feel welcome.
thank Talisha for just blessing our hearts with that beautiful song, Jesus, You're Beautiful to Me. Good morning and or good afternoon, and it's always a privilege to be in the house of the Lord. Our next item listed is the history of the McEachrane Festival of Preaching. However, before we do so, we will invite Dr. Andrews, the past former president of USC, to give some brief remarks.
This is the Victor H. McEachrane Weekend of Preaching. I have five very distinct recollections of Dr. Victor H. McEachrane. However, I will only share one. It was a Sabbath morning like this. It was 32 years ago. I was in the sanctuary of the Hanson Place Church in New York. And Victor McEachrane was also there. He was seated to my right. His daughter was the Sabbath school superintendent. And at a point, unannounced, Victor H. McEachrane stood up in the sanctuary and started to sing without the aid of any amplification or accompaniment. I will just quote the opening part of what he sang, but it encapsulates all that you are putting together here, because it puts together where we want to get. He sang, "There is no disappointment in heaven." I can still hear it. It's ringing in my ear, singing that powerful hymn, which unfortunately many of you probably don't know. You'll hear it one of these days. But in the interim, we want to be in heaven, where there's no disappointment. Amen. That man from Mount St. George to be.
Thank you, Dr. Andrews. Let's give him another round of applause. All right. And now, please lend me your ears. The Victor E. McEachrane Chair of Preaching was initiated in 1995 by Dr. Roy I. McGarrell, who was the Dean of the Faculty of Theology and Religion at what was then the Caribbean Union College. Roy McGarrell wanted to encourage and heighten the sense of excellence in preaching among students. The name Victor E. McEachrane, or Victor McEachrane, was selected because in Dr. McGarrell's mind and experience, McEachrane embodied the preacher par excellence. McEachrane was born in Tobago. Any Tobagonians in the house? Amen. Amen. He was Tobago born. He was an outstanding preacher and evangelist. He has the distinction as being the first Seventh-day Adventist evangelist within this union to have 100 baptisms at an evangelistic campaign. Amen. Amen. Victor E. McEachrane was present for the commencement of the chair named in his honor, which was held in the present reference library, the chapel at that time. He was in his 90s when he delivered a stirring message built on a strong homiletical plot and aptly supported by sound exegesis and contemporary relevance. McEachrane Festival of Preaching has evolved over time. Initially, there was simply a guest speaker, and most notably, Barry Black, Dr. Barry Black. Later, it was sustained by student preachers, as we have now, who demonstrated and displayed promise and potential in the homiletical art and gift. The current format commenced in 2010 and allows us to be well fed by both budding and established preachers. Dr. McGarrell believed that preaching is a calling of the highest order and that it must be done with the Holy Spirit's power and with excellence. It has always been his desire that on this occasion, participants are not in competition, and I repeat, they are not in competition and should not be judged, therefore. He merely wanted us to celebrate this great gift and this great act. Thank you so much for listening.
Our speaker for today is a native of the Trinidad Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, St. Kitts and Nevis. He graduated high school in St. Croix, Sabbath School in 1986. He has served as a pastor in the North Caribbean Conference of Sabbath Medicine since 1991. He has served as secretary of the Committee for Governance, Faith-Based Initiatives for Homeless and Mental Illness under the Mark Porter administration. That was in St. Croix. He has a bachelor's degree in theology as well as a master's in theology from Andrews University. He is currently the stewardship director of the North Caribbean Conference and assistant to the president for evangelism. He's the husband of one wife, father of two young adult children, a man who enjoys enabling people to develop their gifts for the service of God. His ministry motto is, go where you are sent and stick to the task until it is done. Those of you who were here last night, you were there before. For those of you who are here today, you will hear him again. It's none other than Pastor Hesketh Matthew. Amen.
At this time, we will have special music by Sister Spencer. Pastor Saba. I don't see human beings. Pleasant Sabbath, everyone. I think in lessons for living, sometimes one of the most difficult lessons is accepting that God is in complete control. And sometimes we struggle to understand his will. But if we submit ourselves, things will be all right. I pray that you're blessed by the song. Just took a stroll with sand in my toes as the tide rose upon the shores and the harmonies of nature surround. I see the mountains. trees as the leaves for blanket beneath, and the atmosphere God made is so serene. Oh, the longer I look and the see is the prettier it gets to me. It is so amazing how the sunset lights the skies on fire, lovely melodies of the birds on the wire, how beautiful the dewdrops on petals of a rose. God is in control. Somebody tell me how all these things came to be. Oh, I doubt it was accidentally. Oh no, see, there must have been a creator. The world's in his hands, and everything's according to plan. Nothing ever happens by chance. The man goes in season. He is the reason for it all. Yeah. Oh, yes, the longer I look and see is the prettier it gets to me. It is so amazing how the sunset lights the skies on fire, loving melodies of the birds on the wire, how beautiful the dewdrops on the petals of a rose. God is in control. Yes, my God is in control.
Last night, the condiments of music. with all of their confections, have been aptly percolating the atmosphere. And this morning has been no exception. The presence of God is evidently in this place. And if you have sensed His presence, would you say amen? Thank you so much, Dr. Hillary Bowman, the illustrious president of this institution, for allowing for us to celebrate this noble act of bringing a clear resurgence to the relevance of practical, powerful, prophetic preaching. I want to salute you and your administration, and I want to thank the very erudite, yet very amiable and humble Dr. Faz for extending the invitation. I am indebted to Dr. Faz, having sat at his feet. I want to also recognize and salute in his absence the very prolific preacher, Pastor Manzano. As I sat listening last night, I think after 29 years of ministry, I have a little bit of qualification to make an assessment. And I want to contend today that this pack of preachers is one that has demonstrated great prowess and a great proclivity for great preaching. And if I were the union president, I will have no sense of restlessness, for the future of preaching in the Caribbean Union. It would be remiss of me not to salute and to recognize the presence of so many former seditions who have certainly impacted my own journey and in many ways have nurtured me. I want to recognize my first president, Dr. Vernon Andrews. Glad to see you, sir. I also want to recognize the presence of Sister Ward, still looking quite nice and dandy. I want to salute the presence of Pastor Daniel. He was my gift of prophecy teacher. He looks more like a patriarch today. I want to also recognize a classmate and dormitory companion, Dr. Hill. I'm so proud of how you have arisen and assume this position. And Pastor Nichols. And let me not forget my good old friend, Brother Clinton. We have had some days in the dormitory, haven't we? God has been good to CUC, now USA. I must say that I have a covetable observance of the manner in which the praise team conducted worship today. If this is Sabbath at USC, it is a good place to be. And I want to say that I certainly admire the compact, intentional synergizing of what I construe as contemporary music, but not disregarding the presence and the use of the good old hymns. We are experiencing a challenge in the church today where we are having so much hype without a message. And so many of our Generation Z and
the generation, millennials, are missing the theology in the hymns. I am so happy that you, the praise team, are mature enough to consider your audience and still sing the good old hymns of Zion. Ah, there is nothing better than a hymn when you are torn and twisted. And so today, as time has slipped away, I want to fulfill what my teacher asked of me, Dr. Faz, and that is to shape God's impression through a sermon construct. And so I want to talk with us this morning under the subject, Live with Leaving on Your Mind. I wish that you would pray with me as we get into the Word. Our Father, today we confess that we have heard so much during this week. Yet the best of what we have heard still have left us disconcerted. We wish to hear a word from you. So we pray now, precious Lord, that you will just come and put mum to the distracting events of the week. And may the words and the voice of Jesus be heard in this place. And then may we go down from this place, trusting you more intelligently. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Would somebody say, amen. Amen. It was June 26, 2019. Millions of people watched with deep disconsolation as news networks showed the lifeless bodies of a father and his nearly two-year-old daughter laid drowned on the bank of the Rio Grande, Mexico. The Salvadoran father and daughter had been trying to cross the river to get to Brownsville, Texas, in the United States. The father, Oscar Martinez Ramirez, had sold his bicycle and had borrowed money to move his family from El Salvador to the United States. The image of the child tucked inside her father's shirt, her right arm slung around his neck, rushed up against the discarded beer bottles and soda cans, created a train of emotions in people's breasts. Seeing the news that night, a question crept into my spirit and kept on haunting me during the night. The question was, why do people use all of their savings, leave their loved ones, risk their lives battling boisterous waves and tumultuous seas? Watch them. They leave and go on the open seas with the potential ravages of nature. They face the possible destruction and deportation and death. Watch them this morning. They leave in secret, not knowing their faith. Still, I want you to understand that the arduous and difficult struggle that they undertake to leave their home country, and the deprivation and the danger that they face, punctuating the pathway that they must travel to move from their country to that to another country, is not equal, is just minuscule to the comparative, miasmic, xenophobic characters that are costly. Mm-hmm.
So I want to raise the question today. The question is simply this. Why do people leave the comfort of their own home country and dare to discover something that is unknown? Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, as I mulled and cogitated on the question, it dawned upon me that people leave. They are leaving their home country, yearning and expecting to experience something better. I imagine some of you this morning have never had to leave your home country, so you don't know the hurdles and the hard experience of having to leave. Yet I believe that there are some of you this morning who are familiar with the various variant emotions that are associated with leaving one's country and moving to another. While moving presents new and exciting possibilities, the possibility of a new home, the possibility of having new friends, the possibility of new jobs, the possibility of making new and large sum of money, the experts who study human behavior will have us know that the possibility of the stress that is produced by leaving can be equal to the stress of divorce or the stress of having experienced death in one's own family. And so the physical signs of trauma of having to leave one's country is evident in excessive headache and high blood pressure, greater susceptibility to diseases and infection, the emotional roller coaster that can accompany leaving one's country can demonstrate itself through the sense of irritability, panic, and depression. Behaviorally, leaving one's country and relocating can bring in its train an amount of stress that, if not well managed, can lead to incessant fingernail biting. The grinding of one's teeth, the inability to focus, and even drug abuse. I've come by to tell those of you who have never had to leave your country that living can be difficult at times. I've come by to displace your ignorance and inform you that leaving, though it seems simple, can be traumatic at times. As a matter of fact, leaving can be catastrophic. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 5, the Bible says, "And the Lord told Abraham, get up out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house." I want you to sit with me this morning. Let's take some time and mull. Don't rush the text. Take some time and absorb the text. The Lord said unto Abraham, get up out of thy country, from thy kindred, and from thy father's house. I wonder if you've seen the prolixity in the text this morning. I wonder if you're observing the prolixity on words. The Bible says, get up from thy kindred, get up from thy father's house. When I look at the terminology, the word kindred signifies a family and close association. And the word father's house, the term father's house, signifies the same. It seems to me, Dr. Faz, that the author of the text seemed not to want us, the readers, to miss the potential gravity and the hurdle and the potential stress and the intensely intimidating, the gruesome grave of potential that is resident in one having to leave one's country and to move to another. I want to declare today that leaving was far from Abraham's mind. As a matter of fact, leaving was not Abraham's idea. One day God showed up with all clarity God showed up without any form of equivocation. God showed up without any sense of intimidation or intimation, rather. And he said to Abraham, Abraham, you must leave Haran. I want to suggest today that if when one leaves off of one's own will, that leaving has in itself so much potential hurdles and dangers. What is it? Can you imagine the potential emotional roller coaster and the trauma that can come onto a person when he has no sense to leave, but he gets a call from God to say, get up! Move on to Haran. So the deaths of the father and the child prompted the Salvadoran foreign minister, Alexandra Hill, to beg her countrymen to stay and work in El Salvador. She asked them to stick and stay with the government of El Salvador as the government tried to resolve the economic crisis. They said, just stick and stick with us a little longer. Don't go north towards America. I want to suggest to you today that Abraham's country, Haran, was no underdeveloped country. Abraham's country, Haran, was no economic depopulated country. As a matter of fact, Abraham's country, Haran, was no socially depressive country. Please understand today that Abraham was a resident of Haran. They tell me that Haran was a major city in northern Mesopotamia. It was sandwiched between the Euphrates and the Tigris River. They tell me that Haran was a city located on the major trade route between southern Asia and the Mediterranean Sea. They tell me that Haran derived its name because it lay on one of the great road junctions on the Tigris-Euphrates River Valley and the other roads from the north and the west. In other words, Haran was strategically located. Haran was an important trading post. Haran was a religious center. Today, Haran is more familiarly known to us as the great Iraq of the Middle East. Like Paul, I'm contending today that Abraham was a citizen of no mean country. As a matter of fact, the civilization of both Haran and Ur were complex and very developed. Are you still with me out there, somebody? Abraham had grown prosperous in Haran. As a matter of fact, Abraham was 75 years. He was successful and he was satisfied. Abraham was living in this country of prime and pristine land. Abraham was there enjoying the beauty and the serenity of life. And God breaks in and God interrupted his trajectory. And God uproots his plan. And God tells him, without any prior intimidation or intimation, Abraham, you must leave the country. I want you to understand, in those days, there was no opportunity of going to Google to find out the topography of the land. There was no social platform to go on and ask a friend about the flora and the fauna of the land. There was no form of communication for somebody to tell him before about the agricultural potential of the land. All that Abraham knew is that God has spoken and that he must move God's behest. I've come by to tell you this morning that there are times when God will break through and create a theophany and interrupt your plan
may be. In 2020, the voice of God and the call of God is for you and me to begin living with living on our minds. So I imagine that if Abraham's wife were like my mother, she would have noticed a change in Abraham's behavior. You see, an invitation to relocate, whether it's a joyfully received one or one that is creating a sense of shock to you, must create and trigger some kind of expression and modification in one's behavior. And so I imagine that Abraham's wife, Sarah, if she were like my mother, she would have noticed the change in Abraham's demeanor. If she were like my mother, she would have asked him, "What's up with you now?" There have been times when my mother would approach my father when he seeks to conceal what has been disturbing him. Like when the test came back and it was abnormal, that was his prostate test, and it was quite abnormal, he became unusually quiet. But my mother, who studies a man, and I want to say to you sisters, it's a good thing to always study your man. She would study your man, and she would say to him, "What's up with you now?" There would be times when he remains quietly quiet, and he says not a word. And my father would approach him and say, "What's up with you now?" And then he would break out and say, "The man has reneged on the contract." The Bible says that Abraham's wife, Sarah, had not a word to say, but I imagine that she must have had a conversation with the patriarch. She must have asked him, "What's up with you now?" And Abraham must have retorted, "Girl, lately I have had living on my mind. It seems to me that all I've been thinking about, thinking of, is living on my mind." I want to suggest to you, USC, in 2020, maybe this is the time God is calling us to begin living with living on our minds. The parable does not indicate any fuss on the part of Sarah. Maybe Sarah didn't fuss because she understood that the voice and the call came from God. You see, when God asks us to move, our obsession is not in the direction, but our obsession is in the one who invites us to move and the one who is calling and leading the way. So what can we learn from this narrative today? I want to suggest lesson number one, when God invites us to move. As a matter of fact, lesson number one, nobody can have an encounter with God without that encounter with God putting on one's mind a desire to move or to change something or to change a place or to change a habit or to change a religion or to change a relationship or to change a belief or to change a practice or to change a purpose. Are you with me, somebody? When Abraham experienced the call, it was a call to leave the physical country called Haran. When Matthew got the call, it was a call for him to leave the seat of custom. When Peter got the call, it was a call to him to leave his profession. When a Samaritan woman got the call, it was a call for her to leave her lifestyle. When Zacchaeus got the call, it was a call for him to leave his practice. When Paul got the call, it was a call for him to leave his mission. When Abraham got a call,
It was a call for him to leave Hagar. When God meets you and you have an encounter with God, it's always a call to leave. Are you still with me out there? The narrative suggests today that God often moves us from conditions and things and people that satisfy us in an attempt to save us. Are you with me today? Haran, though pristine, Haran, though prime, Haran, though plentiful, was notorious for its idolatry. God asked Abraham to leave Haran because Haran was persuasive and pervasive, rather, with a whole lot of idolatry in it. America, in some people's mind, is the land of promise. Some of us, we get there legally, and some of us even try to get there otherwise. You said illegally, I didn't say that. But I want you to know that every country, whether they are rife and rampant with money, there is a sense of idolatry that is percolating the land. Not just in America, but in the United States Virgin Islands. Not just in the United States Virgin Islands, but in the good old Trinidad and Tobago. I read not too long ago, out of Texas, there was a father named Jerry Younger, who had upon social media the cry, "Please save, save James." What was the issue? There was a battle between him and his wife, Dr. Ann Goggles, over the custody of their 12-year-old son. What was the issue? The issue was that the mother wanted the boy to transition from a boy to a girl. We have come to a time when the LGBTQ movement has become rampant. Not only is the LGBT movement rampant and find itself evident not only among adults but among children and among teenagers, I want you to know that in America today, many times when a child is born and their genitalia are clear and distinct, parents still determine that they won't determine and call their child neither male nor female. They have a new terminology now. They call their children Phoebes, meaning that they are neuter gender, and they are allowing the child to wait until that child grows up and determines what type of gender they will take. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, I've come by to tell you today that there is a sense of idolatry in the land today. There is a shift from biblical godliness. I've come by to declare that in spite of the economic stability that seems to permeate the land, that there is a sense of idolatry in the land, and God is calling a Seventh-day Adventist in 2020. God is communicating to Seventh-day Adventists in 2020. God is seeking to disturb a Seventh-day Adventist. God is seeking to unsettle a Seventh-day Adventist in 2020. And the message is, it is time to begin living with living on your mind. I've come by to say, whatever God requires us to leave can never equal that to which God invites us to cleave. Somebody didn't hear me today. Whatever God invites us to leave can never equal to that which God invites us to cleave. Oh, Paul, having Roman to leave all of the gallantry and the recognition of Rome. He became an imprisoned preacher. But what God had in store for Paul, all of the pomp and the splendor and the Roman accolades could not equal what God had in store for him. I've come by to say, leaving may not be pleasant, but many times it's the only way to be assured of God's eternal presence. How it must prosper us, but it was known for the worship of the goddess of sin. Ah, talk about sin. I never imagined that there would be a time when senators and governors and legislatures would publicly declare their affinity to homosexuality. They tell me I must be proper and I must be sedate and I must be calculated on this message of homosexuality. But I declare this morning, as a preacher, I must love the homosexual. Because they are sons and daughters of God. But in this age of pluralism, I must still declare the biblical construct. The Bible says that all of the profligates and all of the effeminates, God will judge. Please understand today, the call to leave is always an invitation. And not an intimidation. Please understand today that the call to leave is always a choice. God will never force you to leave. But one proverb says, a man is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Please understand today that when God calls, it may not be convenient. And so when God's call disturbs your convenience, you must move in God's behest, based upon your conviction, not upon your convenience. Some of us today need to leave some stuff. We may need to leave our habits. We may need to leave some relationships. We may need to leave some ideologies. We may need to leave a job. Please understand that it matters not how long you have been there. It doesn't matter how long you have been there. When it comes to God, time doesn't matter. Abraham was there 75 years and God enabled him to leave. Please understand that a lack of full disclosure and the presence of an answered question often are part and parcel of the journey of the one who has to leave. So don't tell me today, Pastor, I'm not ready to leave because I can't cross all my dots. I can't cross all my T's and dot all my I's. Don't tell me you're not ready to leave because I can't see all of the intricacies of the way. Please understand that there has never been a man whom God has called, whom God has paved the pathway, a carpet strewn with flowers. Every person whom God has called has to live and move on an unction of faith. So today, as I leave this world to a heavenly king, as we leave worldly ideologies to the biblical construct, I want to suggest to you a few things that you should take. Number one, the Bible says by faith, Abraham, when he was called out into a place which he should receive afterwards of as an inheritance, obeyed and went out, not knowing where he went. May I suggest to you today to take with you a measure of faith. Number one, take with you a measure of faith. Number two, what should you take? The Bible says that by faith, Abraham went out and he took with him his wife. And he took with him his wife. And he took with him his wife. somebody didn't hear me today. The divorce rate in the church is not smaller than the world. We are facing an alarming rate of disconnect and divorce in the church. We need a resurgence of Abraham's appetite and desire to take with him his wife. The Bible says, what should you take? And Abraham took with him Lot, his brother's son. And Abraham took with him other souls that were in heaven. Hear me today. The theme for 2020 is I will go around the Calvin Union. Yet there are people in the church who think that this going and the mission of the church is only the duty of the salaried pastor. There are people in the church who think that the duty and the promulgation of the gospel is only the responsibility of the officers of the church. I want you to understand today that as long as you've had an encounter with God, God invites you to take your spouse. God invites you to take your immediate family. God invites you to take somebody else with you. So don't tell me that you have become so erudite. Don't tell me that you have become so sophisticated. Don't tell me that you have become so learned. Don't tell me that you have become so sedate and so cerebral that the commission of God and the behest of God does not resonate with you. When you look at the dark decadence of the world, there must be a compulsion in your heart to drag somebody with you. So what should you take? The Bible says in Genesis 13, when you go home, read it. The Bible says Abraham and Lot, they heard men reach to a place when there was not enough land for neither one. And the Bible says that there was a conflict between Lot's herdsmen and Abraham's herdsmen. Look here at the prudence and the discretion of Abraham. Abraham said to Lot, Lot's herdsmen, you choose the prime piece of land, and whatever is left, I would advise my herdsmen to take. Listen here, what should you take as you move from earth to the promised land? May I suggest today that there was a need for Seventh-day Adventists to take with them a cadre of soft skills. Somebody said, are you talking about preacher? Well, listen here. You came to USC to develop your hard skills. The hard skills are the training that you will receive. The hard skill is the academic exposure that you will receive. The hard skill is a mental accent that you will give to the data that you will receive. The hard skills will be the certificates and the diplomas on your walls. The hard skills will be your ability to do things well on the job. The hard skills will be how you are able to perform proficiently and efficiently in the execution of your duties. But I spent years in the field, and I've come back to tell you that employers today not only want folks who possess hard skills. As a matter of fact, employers today desire most people who have both hard skills and soft skills. Soft skills has more to do with your temperament. Soft skills has more to do with your personality. Soft skills has most to do with your ability to get along with people. Hard skills has to do with how you're able to manage your anger. Hard skill has to do with conflict management. Listen to me today. Hard skills has you been able to operate under pressure and crisis. Abraham had the construct. He had the consummate possession of the soft skill. Many people in the church have missed the promotion because they have hard skill and no. They sit in the committee and they don't know how to respect the chairman. They have hard skill but know. They are sophisticated and have terminal degrees, but the wife whom God has blessed them with, they can't get along with them. And the children that God has given them, they are leaving the homes. They have hard skills, but no. Some people are so obsessed with their hard skills and proud about their hard skills that when they are living in the church and the rest of the church frowns at their discontentment and their disbehavior and misbehavior rather, listen here, they try to leave the church and form another church. Listen here, when God calls you, He calls you as an individual, but this was never God's intention for you to live out your Christianity by yourself. The Bible says, and God added to the church daily such as should be saved. God wants you to live in this church. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verses 8 to 10. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should have to receive as an inheritance, obeyed and went out, not knowing where he went. We have come to some dark days in the world today. If you are sensitive to the news, you will recognize that there is an unusual avalanche of all kinds of tsunami threats. If you listen to the news, you will recognize that there is an agenda by Rome to facilitate a conversation on environmental interests. Work with a darker agenda. That is to set the world for Sunday's sacredness. If you are listening and not deaf to the thrumming of the word, you will recognize that we are living in rather unusual times. I've come by to sell you see, while you are buried in the books. God lives unaware to the realities of the world. It is time for us to begin living with meaning on our minds. One day, while we are about our normal routines, one day when men are still plotting and politicians are still scheming, and people are still unscrupulous. What now when people are frolicking and dancing with the gangs and the circles of homosexuality? Ellen G. White said, we're going to see a cloud appearing in the sky. It's going to be just about the size of a man's hand. And the closer it gets, the more brilliant it becomes. It's going to fill up the sky with splendor in a dramatic presence. Then we are going to hear the sounds of trumpets, and myriads upon myriads of angels. Ladies and gentlemen, I trust today that you have not become too educated to believe it. I trust today that you have not lived and served long enough that you have forgotten it. The Bible says, as they saw him going up, he said to them, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? That same Jesus that is taken away from you up into heaven shall so come in like manner as he has seen him grow. Ladies and gentlemen, I've had my own bit of struggle. I carry a scar from my own operation that doctors said would have been a possibility of non-survival. I've seen people pulled in the darkened cabins of death. I've seen families struggled and split. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been down in the trenches, and I know from the heart that it's time for us as Seventh-day Adventists to begin living.
With me.
To join me in saying, Pastor, dear Lord Jesus, as I get ready to leave the first month of the year 2020, help me in all my doings, in all of my activities, to keep focus and to live with meaning on my mind. Anybody wants to join me in saying that today? Just raise your hand. If you really mean it, would you just stand to your feet as we pray? Oh, precious Lord, today, here we have stood in the congregation of the saints. We want to confess today that we have not all been what you wanted us to be. Ah, the glimmer of this world sometimes eclipse your promise. But one day you will come. Oh God, today we pray that this promise, the occasion, the birth of this your church, will always burn in our hearts. When we open our textbook, may we do it believing in our minds. When we conduct business, may we do it with leaving on our minds. When we interact with our spouses and children, may we do it with leaving on our minds. When we project and plan for this university, may we do it with leaving on our minds. When we sit in the seat of judgment, may we do it with leaving on our minds. So when the skies break, and the mountains are skipping, and the sea boils like a giant pot, and Jesus Christ comes in, oh God, may we look up and say, this is our God. We have long waited for him. And he will save us. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
The call is to live with leaving on our minds. The question is, how far from home? As the praise team come forward, we invite you to stand. As we make use of hymn number 439, how far from home?
Thank you. deaconesses, please, and all those students assigned to you as a church. Deacons, deaconesses, students assigned to you.